नमस्कार, महा एम टी व्ही लाईव्हमध्ये आपल्या सर्वांचं मनपूर्वक स्वागत. आणि आपल्यासोबत एक विशेष व्यक्तिमत्व आहे की एक असा देश ज्याविषयी भारतीयांना खूप आकर्षण आहे, तिथल्या राष्ट्रवादाविषयी आपल्याला खूप आश्चर्य असतं, ते म्हणजे इस्रायल. आणि त्या इस्रायलच्या विश्वविख्यात हिब्रू युनिव्हर्सिटीत शिकवणारे राज्यशास्त्र, इतिहास आणि तत्वज्ञान अशा विषयांचे अभ्यासक आणि प्राध्यापक डॉक्टर गादी ताऊब आपल्यासोबत स्टुडिओमध्ये आहेत आणि ते आपल्यासोबत या सर्व विषयांवरती चर्चा करणार आहेत, राष्ट्रीयतेवरती, राष्ट्रवादावरती आणि भारतीय इस्रायल संबंधांवरती. वेलकम डॉक्टर गादी ताऊब प्रोफेसर इन आवर स्टुडिओ.
थँक्यू फॉर हॅव्हिंग मी.
आय वुड लाईक टू बिगिन द टॉक विथ द स्टेटमेंट इश्यूड बाय फ्यू पर्सन्स इन इंडिया अगेन्स्ट द प्रोग्राम हेल्ड ऑन यस्टरडे ॲट मुंबई युनिव्हर्सिटी. दे कॉल देमसेल्फ डेमोक्रॅटिक फोर्सेस अँड दे प्रिटेंड टू बी सेव्हियर ऑफ फ्रीडम ऑफ स्पीच अँड एक्सप्रेशन, बट अनफॉर्च्युनेटली दे यस्टरडे क्रिटिसाइज द फ्री डिस्कशन अँड फ्री प्रोग्राम. वॉट वुड बी युअर मेसेज फॉर देम?
Well, first of all, it's funny that you protest the right of others to speak in the name of freedom of speech. But I think that I'm not surprised. This is happening all over the world. And I would also challenge the idea that they are the democratic forces. I think that what we are seeing globally, and this has to do with the new flowering of Indian Israeli relationship, is the rise of democratic nationalism, and the left is desperately trying to call this fascism all the time. But the fact is that democracy is in many places now on the side of the right. Why? Because we are seeing a globalist trend, an attack in the name of liberalism against the nation state, and they have a vision of a global village. But in this global village, how will you and I vote? Who will be the government? And what they see in front of their eyes as a global village is the European Union. And the European Union has, in the eyes of many Europeans, replaced democracy with bureaucracy. So yeah, the way to protect your democratic rights is to protect the nation state.
Yeah, the nationhood is essential. You talked about the Indo-Israel relationship. We see nowadays Indo-Israel relationship is a prospering and the reasons behind it, what you suggest, do you think the credit goes to Narendra Modi and the reasons are merely political, geopolitical, international relations or ideological and cultural similarities between the India and Israel?
Well, I think that you can give a lot of credit to both Modi and Netanyahu for understanding the commonalities. But I think that what they have realized are the deeper trends are similar in India and in Israel. And India has moved in its relation to Israel from the Gandhi Congress conception, which is more multicultural and less national, to a conception more similar to Zionism. What has Zionism done? Zionism has taken Judaism, which was originally a religious identity, and transformed it into a national secular identity. By secular, I don't mean anti-religious. I mean extra-religious, outside religion. My father was a secular Jew. My mother was a secular Jew. And I think that what now the Modi's party is trying to advance is Hindutva, is a conception of Hindu identity beyond Hindu religion, in a way that even if you are not religiously Hindu, you can still be part of the Hindu nation. So leaders have seen the similarities and understood the keen relationship that can be between two democratic national movements.
There are cultural threads between the India and Israel, and that we can give credit little bit to the cultural and ideological similarity between the India and Israel also.
I agree.
But you talked about the Zionism. Zionism is the philosophy or the idea. But there are common grounds in between Hindutva and Zionism. And would you like to point out some, or which you considered essential values of Zionism and Hindutva, but they go hand in hand or parallel to each other?
I think they are parallel, and I think there are differences, because it was very interesting to listen yesterday to Dr. Swami explain this. But if you consider the relationship of Muslims and Jews in in Israel, then the one thing all Israelis, Muslims and Jews agree on is that they are not the same nation. These are two peoples. We are a Jewish nation state, a Zionist nation state, with a Muslim minority, which is a national minority. What Dr. Soami said yesterday is that in his conception, Muslims can also be Hindu by national identity, so that Muslims will be only a religious, not a national identity in India. And this is a very interesting model. I hope it will succeed. It is not the model for Israel, because in Israel, the Muslims want to retain their separate national identity. So Israel, to accommodate this in our Declaration of Independence, Muslim citizens don't only have equal rights, they can vote. We have an Arab Muslim on the Supreme Court. We have Arab Muslim parties in our parliament. But also they have collective rights. So the state will finance a Muslim school system in Arabic so that the minority can preserve its identity without losing its right. And all this is happening when we still have a war with the rest of their nation outside our country. Yeah. So it's a complicated situation. I know you have also Kashmir, Pakistan. I can't say that India is simple. Yeah, and
many British administered channels calls it Indian administered Kashmir, as it has been with the Palestine and Israel. But these are different issues. Yesterday, you quote Veer Savarkar, Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, the philosopher who first invented the idea of political Hindutva. Savarkar's Hindutva and Savarkar's concept of Hindutva is more political than customary or religious. Is this same with the conception of Zionism in your eyes and the eyes of Israel?
It has many similarities, and this is why Savarkar, immediately after the UN voted for partition and the right of Jews to their own state, Savarkar lamented. He said, in my country, there is too much Muslim propaganda and people don't understand the justice of the cause of Zionism. So I think that the move of India to closer to Savarkar is also a movement closer to Israel. Israel. And we can only be happy about it, because, you know, I think there is, I see amazing potential. The Jewish culture is a culture of controversy. No two people agree on anything. This is why Israel is like a soda. It's bubbling with amazing ideas all the time, but there is not enough ground to try them. In my profession, for instance, I write drama, TV drama. You don't have Bollywood audience. We have 8 million people. So we have a lot of ideas, but not enough audience to support it. So if there will be, as I hope there will be, cooperation in the film industry, then a lot of Israelis' ideas in India, I heard you have a big audience.
Yes. India is a big market for every community.
1 billion people, we can't imagine this. You know, you can put Israel 5 times inside Mumbai and you will not notice.
So that is one of the advantages of Indian economy, that it has lots of consumers and for every commodity. It's maybe it entertainment or energy.
And you know, it's not just my profession, it's also in high tech, in water technology, in military technology, in everything. Israel can bring a lot of ideas, and where there is a big market, it's fruitful for cooperation.
Sir, in India, there is an organization, Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh, or RSS. Once upon a time, Mr. Modi was a full-timer of RSS also. This RSS organization tried to streamline the idea of nationalism in India. And now we are seeing the rise of nationhood and the idea of national identity. But many people, again, those funny people who issued statement yesterday against you, that type of historians or the political thinkers tried to connect the idea of Indian nationhood and nationalism with the idea of Hitler's Nazism and nationalism. As a member of a community which had been exploited a lot by the jingoism of Hitler, do you think this philosophical linkage is correct?
No, I think that what happened in Germany is that since the European powers did not let German nationalism develop peacefully, they tried to suppress it ended up violently exploding. the real antidote to Hitlerism and to fascism and to radical nationalism is moderate nationalism. If you give people a way to express their own national identity, then they become more peaceful. The father of Zionism, Theodor Herzl, said very beautifully in his book Alt Neuland, which is in German, a new old land. He said, only when all peoples have a homeland will they be kind towards each other. This is what Zionists believe in, and I think that the attempt of the left to classify every form of nationalism as Hitlerism is badly mistaken, because nationalism is what binds a community together. It is what will make you, if God forbid there is a war and you are conscripted, you will go to fight for other people. What makes you fight for these people? It's beyond family, it's beyond tribe, it's beyond caste. It's something larger, it's your national identity, and national identities make democracies function. I'll say just one sentence about this because it's important. What makes a person use the vote, not for his private good, but for the public good? Patriotism. So without nationalism, democracy is not a square on the map where you give everyone the vote.
Yeah.
It is a unit where people care about each other. So you need to make, and I think Modi is absolutely right, because it's the road to cure the ills of Indian societies, which I am not an expert on, should begin with caring about each other, with having a common national identity and national solidarity.
Yeah, and the contract based on the individual oriented philosophy cannot be worked out, all these things which needs to secure the democracy.
Absolutely.
The democratic nationalism, yesterday also you explore this subject a much better way, but so far the India is concerned, how would you like to define the nationalism in context of Indian constitution and democratic values?
Well, I'm not knowledgeable enough on India to comment intelligently on that, but I can only say that it seems to me that that Indians generally have been very thirsty to hear Modi's message. In Israel, we didn't know that he will win so generously in the general elections, but we are certainly happy, because you know India is such a big portion of humanity. It's such a, and it's the majority. Most people who live in a democracy live in India. It's more than half the democratic world. So what is happening here, people look up to, and as a Zionist, I wish Indians to have a healthy national democracy in order to thrive.
Yeah, I mean, see, it would be, it is a necessary for the preservance of democracy at international and global context also.
I am absolutely confident that this is the case.
Yeah, thank you. So, according to you, the self-determination is the one of the core value of democratic nationalism. Which should be the context and ground for the self-determination? Regional, cultural, or ideological, or political? Because there is everywhere talk that self-determination, so in studio we will have a self-determination, in the streets we will have a self-determination. So boundaries,
know,
how would you define the boundaries?
I know where the landmine in this question is, around the Kashmir, because yesterday the question arose, and Dr. Swami said, you know, we are willing to have a self-determination referendum of all of India, not of separately of Kashmir. And well, I didn't have the microphone. I leaned over and I whispered in his ear. I told him, you are like Abraham Lincoln. Because Abraham Lincoln in the Civil War, before the Civil War, this is what he said. He said, the South declared the self-determination. We are a separate country. And Abraham Lincoln said, one nation under God. We are the same nation. So a referendum always applies only to all of us. So I can see the reasoning behind the BJP conception of the question of Kashmir. In order to comment more intelligently, I would have to know much, much more about the complicated politics of regions in India. And I can only hope that this is resolved peacefully.
Yeah. Sir, you are from a background of a university and you have been teaching for years in Hebrew University, the academic field, the mostly education seems to be or has been much influenced by the so-called left-wing or communist intellectuals. And why is it so? We experienced in India this same...
This is where the petition came from against our event yesterday. I know this kind of academic style. I think that the left has been losing power in politics, and it has been trying to entrench itself inside non-elected bodies. Academia in Israel, also the Supreme Court, to a very large extent. And much to my regret, in academia, in many departments, you will find the majority of the faculty anti-Zionist, anti-Israeli. Not all departments. Yeah, there are some departments. But I would say that there is a very strong tilt to the Marxist left, and I find myself in a very tiny minority. I always, and it's also like that in the media in Israel. So I tell my friends in the media, you know, we on the nationalist right, we are always a minority except in the elections.
Means we have to define a new term in India and Israel context, that intellectual minority, or we can say academic minority, and we never get a representation also to represent our ideas.
But now you see a resurgent, right? I mean, the people who talk now about Savarkar are these are the spring of original ideas now. The left has just been repeating the same anti-national stuff. We have heard this since Karl Marx and up to here. They've always told us that nationalism is just around the corner dying.
Yeah.
But it's always after 70 years of communism trying to suppress nationalism. The minute the Berlin Wall fell, 91, Gorbachev was ousted, nationalism rose all over Eastern Europe.
Yeah, and all the communist parties also then become nationalist realistic
because
context.
Because no other basis for functioning democratic self-determination so far exists, except rarely. You know, there is Switzerland, but there is Switzerland and there is Belgium, but it's very, very rare.
Yeah, specifically talking about communists and the ideology of left-wing. Most of the left-wing thinkers who wrote it and who drafted and who gave an intellectual argument to the whole idea was from the background, or we can say the origin lies there in the Zionist origin. Means the Karl Marx or the Antonio Gramsci we consider. So why it happened? Because that time the Jews were minorities in all over the world, and
yes,
they were being persecuted. So was that psychological conflict in between the minds of Karl Marx or the Antonio Gramsci which resulted into the writing of Das Kapital and the ideas of neo-Marxism and all these things? How do you look at this?
Well, I think it was a grand historical mistake. Marxism had the force of a religion, because it's not just an analysis of economics, which is a flawed analysis of economics. It's also a promise of complete redemption and complete justice. But after we had the experience of the 20th century, one thing we can say for sure: Marxism as a political system can only exist under extreme oppression. Whenever you try to implement Marxism, if you don't oppress the people, they will rebel against it. So after about 150 million corpses, I think we should say enough. We have tried this, it doesn't work.
Yeah, and now they have started raising slogans against the nationalism, and whenever there is a rise of democratic nationalism, the left always link it to the Hitler and Mussolini, and it has now become a rhetoric, intellectual rhetoric in the context. And I'm happy to hear from you that anti-national is not only the term defined in India, because the Indian intellectuals, they say that this term is defined by only...
We hear this all over the Western world, but I think that now the right, the sane, liberal, conservative right is a moderate worldview, and it is certainly against fascism and Hitlerism.
Can we say that the neo-Marxism was the product of exploitation by anti-democratic forces? Or are those philosophical interpretations relevant today? Means the interpretations by Antonio Gramsci or the Karl Marx, and the list goes on.
I think that it is relevant only in the university. It is only a theoretical, intellectual exercise. It has nothing to do with politics, because when you look at the global scene, you will see that capitalism has brought the blessing of prosperity to all successful nations. And there are two forces that you can say clearly bring prosperity, I think. It's free market economy on the one hand and gender equality on the other hand. Wherever you oppress women, you have a failed economy. And wherever you try to replace the mechanism of the market with a planned government economy, you have starvation and oppression.
Yeah. Sir, second last question. The Jews never persecuted in India. They welcomed, they flourished, prospered in this soil. At that time, there was nothing such as a United Nations Minority Commission, United Nations Minority Consensus, or anything such. There was not even the concept was introduced in the political science, such as there should be a special protection to the minorities, and all these things were never at that time. But still, India behaved much progressive, if we consider the age, that age. So the reason lies in Hindu way of living, or do you consider any other reason for that behavior, for that gesture of India towards minorities, and it for many decades?
Well, I am a believer in such a thing as a national mentality and a national temperament. And I think that there is something blessedly gentle about the Indian temperament. I think that Indian culture, Indian philosophy and Indian spiritual culture is genuinely tolerant and gentle, and I welcome its influence everywhere. You should know that Israelis love it. Israelis, we have a compulsory army conscription in Israel. Yeah. We go to 3 years in the army, and a great many Israelis, after they finish the army, they go to India. It's almost a sociological ritual to go, you know, to Pune, to an ashram, to some trip around the Indian temples, to breathe a different form of spirituality and come back with enriched in your culture. So I think that before the leaders have created a stronger bond, there was, at least on the Israeli side, there was an affinity and a genuine love of Indian culture.
Yeah. Sir, we may proceed to the conclusion of the talk. Sir, the many people now all over the world, we see the rise of democratic nationalism, and it is getting accepted by the society also. There are many intellectuals, academicians, who will be calling it the fascism and the Mussolini, and they will link it to the Hitler. But as a democratic nationalist thought leaders, you and the India, what should be their future agendas? Means there are a rise of nationalist democratic forces everywhere, in all over the world. So from your point of view, what should be their future agendas, and what would be the coming years, how this democratic nationalism or the constitutional nationalism will define the path?
I think I can say two short things about it, that we have two fronts to fight on. One, democratic nationalism should make a clear break with any extreme nationalism which is in any way fascist or racist. So this is one front where we have to put a line and say we are democratic, tolerant and conservative. The other front is we should say we will resist globalization. Not in the sense that we resist a global free market, but we will resist the attempt to dismantle and to take apart nation state. The vision that democratic nationalism has of a global community is a family of nations. It's not a global village like the John Lennon song Imagine. We don't want a world with no borders, no religion, no national identity. No, we want everyone to have their nation state, and then those nation states can become a family of nations.
This was Dr. Professor Gadi with MyMTB and Mumbai Tarun Bharat. We thank you, sir, once again. And you, very short notice, you arranged the time for us and come here and exchange the ideas with us. And it will surely help to the Indian nationalism also in future to grow and prosper.
My pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. आपल्यासोबत होते प्रोफेसर गादी तौब, त्यांनी आपल्यासोबत संवाद साधलेला आहे. आणि सावरकर, हिंदुत्व, राष्ट्रीय स्वयंसेवक संघ, भारताचा राष्ट्रवाद, इस्रायलचा राष्ट्रवाद, ते आत्तापर्यंत अकॅडमिक आणि मीडियामध्ये असलेले एक सो कॉल्ड प्रोग्रेसिव्ह किंवा ज्यांना पुरोगामी स्वतःला म्हणवतात असे सगळेच, आणि ज्यांना सध्या अँटीनॅशनलही म्हटलं गेलं आहे त्यांच्या काही वक्तव्यांमुळे, त्या सर्व विषयांवरती त्यांनी संवाद साधलेला आहे, स्पर्श केला. खरोखरच आपण प्रेक्षकांच्या वतीने तुम्हाला धन्यवाद, आणि पुन्हा भेटू उद्या एका नव्या विषयासह. तोपर्यंत थँक्यू.